Now, making schools smaller, yet another plan to deliver better educations to urban school children. Special correspondent John Tulenko reports from New York City, where the outgoing school's chancellor is a big supporter of the idea.
2 years ago, when Justin Martinez started ninth grade, he was one of 2,000 students at Baird Rustin High School in New York City.
When you walk the halls, it's like so packed. And then when you're in the classroom, some kids don't even have a seat. So it's like you're standing up, you're sitting on the floor, you're sitting on the teacher's desk. There's so many kids in the room that the teacher thinks you're doing good and you may not even understand what's going on. That's how bad it was.
Justin's high school had a 50% graduation rate, but the problems there went deeper.
I almost got shot. I was going to my eighth period classroom, going up the stairs, and a gang came up to me, approached me, and asked me questions, blah, blah, blah. And at the end, they pointed a gun to my face.
So what did you do?
I was shocked. Like, I just stopped. And I didn't know what to do, you know? I was just shocked. I was scared. I didn't want to die, you feel me? And, you know, I was there, like, and they was just talking, like, having a conversation. And one of the kids asked, should I do it? Like, should I pull the trigger? And once he turned around, I was by the stairs, and I just ran down the stairs, and I was just gone.
Did you go back to school the next day?
I went to the precinct and filed out a report to get out of the school.
Shortly after that happened, New York City shut down Justin's school. For the last 8 years, the city has been closing large, dangerous, and low-performing high schools, 26 to date.
I am proud of large numbers of big schools we have in this city, and I could go through the city and show them to you. What I'm not happy with is a large school that has a 35 or a 40 or a 45% graduation rate.
Joel Klein is New York City's schools chancellor.
And if I think a school has got the kind of failure culture, low expectations, non-performance, my job is to create a different option for those kids.
That different option has been small high schools, like this one, Williamsburg Prep, where Justin now goes to school.
When you come here, it feels like you have so much more room, you have so much more, like, attention.
I don't think she was, like, crazy.
The teachers are willing to let you ask questions, willing to let you come after school, you know? So it's, like, better for you. It's better for a lot of kids, you know?
Enrollment at Williamsburg Prep is around 500. It's a quarter the size of most large high schools. Ben Lockeritz teaches math.
It's a small school where the teachers are very talented and work very, very hard, and the administration is on top of the teachers to make sure that's really happening, and we don't let kids fall through the cracks.
Alrighty.
Small schools can do things large schools cannot. For instance, Williamsburg Prep designs its schedule so that the students in each grade have the same lunch period as their teachers.
So a student, if he's falling behind in one of his classes, can find those teachers for extra help. If he misses a day of school, he can find those teachers for extra work and not fall farther behind.
In small schools like this one, it's even easy to schedule planning periods so teachers of the same subjects meet at the same time.
I think it's easier for everybody to know everybody. I get to talk to most teachers in the school several times a week. Some of them will say, well, what are you doing here again? That where they came from, they never saw the principal.
Principal Kathleen Elvin started this school 6 years ago.
Ideally, the place should look like a private school. So it may seem very minor, but it's really important to me that the furniture matches, that the furniture is clean, that the classrooms are clean. It has to feel like everything about the place is cared about because the people who come here are so important.
Right, that is factored. That is not the answer.
Williamsburg Prep offers a traditional academic curriculum. Other small schools the city created have different themes. This is the high school for violin and dance. It has 259 students. Tanya John is principal.
What's special about our school is that we give students the opportunity who haven't had the chance for the arts.
What's a typical day like?
A normal program is math, science, English, social studies, violin, dance. They get the opportunity to do both every day.
How do you select who gets to come here?
We do not. It's random high school application process, just having the desire, just like any other New York City high school, no different.
So it doesn't matter if I've never taken violin or dance?
98% of them have not.
Other small high schools focus on business, law, science and engineering, media, sports management, and more. In all, over an 8-year period, New York City created 123 small, theme-based, open admission high schools from scratch. What are the results?
The results are compelling now. I mean, schools that we shut down, like in Bushwick, and we had a lot of community resistance. That school had a 28% graduation rate. The schools that replaced it have 72%. And some of these schools are getting really outsized results.
Like Williamsburg Prep, where the graduation rate is 88%. And the High School for Violin and Dance, where it's 83%.
That's all good, but it's not the whole story. There's also been a downside. When the city closed a large high school with, say, 2,000 students, it was replaced by small schools, serving, in most cases, hundreds of students less. And each time that happened, all those leftover teenagers had to find somewhere else to go to school.
The solution? New York City sent them to large, often crowded schools it hadn't closed.
When I explained to high school admissions that, yes, we're large, but we're not large enough to have walls that expand, it didn't really matter.
Joanne Frank was principal at Norman Thomas High School when the new students arrived.
We had 3,300 students on register for a building whose capacity was 1,800. We had 500 to 600 over-the-counter students. It was almost claustrophobic.
According to Clara Hemphill, a longtime watcher of the city's public schools, these over-the-counter students, as the department called them, weren't just any students.
The new small schools didn't accept kids who were new to the country or kids with special education needs in the first couple of years. So disproportionate numbers of very needy kids were diverted and sent to the remaining large high schools. They had lots more needy kids, and they didn't get any more resources to help them.
At 15 of these large schools, graduation rates fell. This was the reaction soon afterward, when 8 became targets for closing.
You know, there are communities that are quite angry because they said, you know, we had a great school 8 years ago, and now, you know, we have a school that has all sorts of problems, but we don't feel it was of our doing.
Michael Mulgrew is president of the local teachers union. Last winter, it filed a lawsuit to stop the city from closing another 17 high schools.
I know that this could have been done better. To me, we should have had a mechanism in place that if we switched the population or did a complete integration of a new population in a school, we are also saying, listen, we know that your population is changing, the needs are changing, and we're giving you these things that will help you. That was not happening.
But Chancellor Klein's view is different.
I think we should be candid about it. I think the pushback is from the union that this dislocates teachers. And the teachers do not like it, because if I come in and I start a new school, that means you have fewer kids. If you have fewer kids, particularly in tight budget times, you have fewer teachers. And I think that's what this is about. It's a game about who has the power.
It didn't take the court long to decide the matter, and it ruled in favor of the union, putting a temporary halt to school closings.
What the court said was you can't close the schools without coming up with a good plan for what you're going to do with the kids who are displaced. And I think the Department of Education did not think carefully enough about what was going to happen to those kids.
We've created over the course of the years the number of seats that we shut down. I think the numbers are quite clear, and I'd be happy to get them to you. I think we do have the seats and the capacity.
But the criticism is that you didn't have a plan.
We may not have done our job thoroughly enough, and this year we've started earlier. We're engaging the communities more effectively, and I think that's an important point. But it's always going to be controversial. And if it's not controversial, it's a pretty good indication that it's not going to be powerful. If people want the same results, they can do the same old, same old. If people want different results, and we've gotten much different results in New York, they're going to have to do the tough work.
Even with the problems, New York City's overall graduation rate has improved by 10%. But the job's far from over. Nearly half the city's 300,000 high school students are still in large schools. And if any of those change, it won't be under Chancellor Klein. He's resigned effective January 1st.